Okay, give me one second. I need to mute everyone. Mute participants on stream. Mute all. Disable that. Yes. Chris ABC. Unmute. Chris, unmute. Okay, can both of you speak for me?
Can you hear me?
Yep, and Chris?
Yeah, I'm here as well, Ejaz.
Okay, good. I just confirm that you guys can hear me and I can hear you. Just give me one second. So I changed the time for the cross examination, by the way. Okay, I have Chris here. I have the alarms here. Okay. Just give me one second. Put that there. Okay, there we go. Okay. I'm about to start recording. Okay, guys. What's the debate topic for tonight again? Right. Let me just refresh this page.
Just for Jay, what the we're just correct. We're changing the times of the crossfire from 15 minutes to 10 minutes each.
Yeah, 10 minutes. That's correct.
Okay. Right.
Okay, so I'm going to start recording now. Okay, I muted everyone. I have the alarm ready. Okay, record to cloud. All right, assalamu alaikum. Good night, everyone. We're here for the second debate between Mr. Chris Claus and Brother Aqil. Tonight's debate is Muhammad, peace be upon him, prophesied about in the Torah and the Injil? It starts at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, which is now, and the format is as follows. 15-minute opening statement each, 7-minute rebuttals each, 5-minute rebuttals each, 10-minute cross-examination each, 5-minute closing each. I'm not sure if there'll be a Q&A tonight. We'll let the debaters decide after they've finished their concluding statements. Just one point of note. Last night, we did have, during the cross-examination, the person asking the question being stopped from asking their question, right? So both debaters were guilty of this. So we're asking tonight if, when it's your turn to cross-examine, you question. When it's the other person to cross-examine, you let them ask you questions. Okay, guys? We got to stick to the rules. Okay, so tonight I believe Aqil is beginning. He'll be starting first. It is a 15-minute opening statement. Let me just set that here. 1500. Okay, Aqil, let me know when you're ready. I'll have to mute Chris.
Okay.
Let me know when you're ready.
Oh, give me one second.
Okay. Right, so just be you and Chris on the screen, okay? And Aqil, if possible, can you put the camera a bit back? People said that your face was too close to it. Now, I'm sure you have a nice face, but...
Okay, no problem. It's we're situated on the desk, but okay. I hope that's a little bit better.
Yeah, it should be better, inshallah. Okay, guys, let me know when you're ready to start, okay, Aqil?
Okay, one second.
Just a reminder, when you are 1 minute until your time is up, you'll hear this sound. And when your time is up, you'll hear. And from then, you have 15 seconds to complete, okay?
Okay.
Let me know when you're ready.
Okay, ready.
Okay, you might begin.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursaleen. Sayyidina Habibina Nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Again, welcome to all. And also, I want to thank in onset, again, Chris for the invitation and his staff who accommodated us, as well as Ejaz for the coordination and all those responsible for helping facilitate these events for this weekend. Last night was a success in terms of debate. It went well, and we got very good feedback, and we pray the same for tonight. And we hope people are benefiting from the information that is shared, as well as enjoying the dialogue. So tonight's topic is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied about in the Torah and the Injil? And before we can faithfully answer the question of tonight's topic, we first must acknowledge the fact about the Torah and the Injil. For not defining these two sources will cause failure to facilitate our answer to the question. Now, the Torah specifically refers to the first five books of the Jewish scripture given to Musa and Moses, alayhi salam, peace be upon them, or what is commonly known as the Old Testament. So it's the first five books that is comprised in the Old Testament of today's Bible. But also, the Torah has a generic usage that is applied to the whole of the Jewish scripture and not only specifically to the first five books of the Old Testament. As for the Injil, it is a revelation from God given to Jesus, Isa, alayhi salam. It is a revelation from God given to Jesus, Isa, alayhi salam. And from that Injil of Isa, alayhi salam, today there exist four testimonies of early historical figures at or around the time of Jesus that wrote about the Injil that Jesus preached. So for instance, in the New Testament, as is commonly and widely known, we have four Gospels. We have the Gospel of Matthew, the Gospel of Mark, the Gospel of Luke, and the Gospel of John. But we don't have a Gospel of Jesus or a Gospel of Isa. So we, in having not having this Gospel of Isa, we are taking what the historical figures wrote about Isa and about his gospel as a source by which we can find out what exactly did Jesus say to some extent in his own gospel, or the gospel that he's preached, as mentioned in the Bible, that Jesus went out and preached the gospel. But the actual Injil of Jesus remains to be a serious case of contention amongst many. For argument's sake, we are conveniently addressing the Torah as the Old Testament and the Injil as the New Testament for conveniently sake, but with conditions. And those conditions are the fact that although the Muslims acknowledge the reality of previous scripture and their respective recipients, meaning the prophets and messengers who they were sent to, we also testify to the fact of scriptural distortion and misappropriation. Thus, as Muslims, we look at every part of the previous scripture with the eye of scrutiny and objectivity. Because the entire body cannot be seen as a complete reliable source in and of itself. So I know it's going to be asked, how is it possible for you to say the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is prophesied in the Bible when you don't believe in the Bible or the Old Testament or the New Testament? The position of the Muslim is that we believe revelation came to previous prophets and messengers of time of old. We believe that some, or we don't know exactly what percentage of that remains, but we do believe it does remain in what is called the Old Testament. And we do believe that we find also the remnants of that in the New Testament. What's consistent with the Quran, because we believe the Quran is the final revelation of God, what's consistent with the Quran, we see and we accept, and also what's consistent with reality, and what goes against that, we reject. And what the Quran is silent about, we don't have a say for or against it. And that's the position of the Muslim. So we can look into the Old Testament and the New Testament and see that these things are, in fact, aligned with history as relates to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we can draw these things out and bring these prophecies that we understand to be in the Old Testament or New Testament about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, given this fact, let us advance to our subject. And that subject, first and foremost, we want to look at the prophecy in the Old Testament. And this prophecy, we want to look at two, at least, in the Old Testament, and then one, if we have time, in the New Testament. That prophecy, first and foremost, is in the book of Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, chapter 21, verses 5 to 17. It says, in Isaiah 21, 5, they set the tables, they spread the rugs, they eat, they drink, and get up, you officers, or you the shields. This is what the Lord says to me. Go, post a lookout, and have him report what he sees. When he sees chariots with teams of horses, riders of donkey, and riders of camels, let him be alert, fully alert. And the lookout shouted, day after day, my Lord, I stand on the watchtower. Every night I stand on my post. Look, here comes a man in a chariot with a team of horses. And he gives back the answer, Babylon has fallen. All the images of his gods lie shattered on the ground. My people who crush on the threshing floor, I tell you what I have heard from the Lord Almighty, from the God of Israel. A prophecy against Duma. Someone calls me from Seir, Watchman, what is left on the night? Watchman, what is left on the night? The watchman replies, morning is coming, but also the night. If you would ask, then ask, and come back yet again. And then we go into verse 13, a prophecy against Arabia. A prophecy against Arabia. You caravans of Dedanites who camp in the thickets of Arabia, bring water for the thirsty. You live in Tama. Bring food for the fugitives. They flee from the sword, from the drawn sword, from the bent bow, from the heat of battle. This is what the Lord says to me. Within 1 year, as a servant bound by contract would count it, all the splendor of Kedar would come to an end. The survivors of the archers, the warriors of Kedar would be few. The Lord, the God of Israel, has spoken. This is the first prophecy that we believe when we look at history. It refers directly to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And let us start at 13, where it mentions a prophecy against Arabia. I mentioned the previous verses to give us a context, to be honest to the text, so we can understand what's going on here. It's a prophecy. So in the beginning, we have, it mentions about riders of donkeys and riders of camels, and also riders of horses. As it relates to the riders of camels, then we identify this with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because at his time, the mode of transportation, one of the main ones was camels. And this is what they use for their mode of transportation. Then we go down, it says, you caravans of Dedanites. Who are the Dedanite people? The Dan is a place in Arabia. And the Dedanite people are people who in the first century migrated from an area to the place in what is now termed Medina, or very close to Medina, who camp in the thickets of Arabia. Bring water for the thirsty. You live in Tama. Where's Tama? Tama is also in Arabia, in Medina area. And this is geographically established and it cannot be refuted. Bring food for the fugitives. They flee from the sword, from the drawn sword, from the bent bow, and from the heat of battle. What is this talking about? The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, for 13 years in Mecca, were being persecuted by the people of Arabia. And he fled from Arabia to where? To Medina, to this area of Tama, in this area where the people gave him asylum. So it says, bring food for the fugitives. Meaning, take them in, honor them. And this is what we see happen during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what your Lord says to me. And within 1 year, as a servant bound by contract would count it, all the splendor of Kedar would come to an end. The survivors of the archers, the warriors of Kedar would be few. The Lord, the God of Israel, has spoken. After a short period of time, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, within about 2 years after his migration from Mecca to Medina, He went and he fought and had a war with the people who persecuted him and chased him out. They won that battle. It's called the Battle of Badr. So it says that their splendor would come to an end. The splendor of the Meccans, the Mushrikeen that persecuted the Muslims, they lost the battle. And then when we look at the long-term effect, when the Muslims finally came back to Mecca to establish it, there was very few people who disbelieve in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the people of Kedah who oppressed them in the beginning, it says their numbers would be few. There would be few. And this was the case of those who fought and oppressed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a prophecy that we see history. It does add up to history and it adds up to the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's a prophecy that according to the Bible, the Lord has given. Now, Chris would come tell us, or reject it and say, this is not talking about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and give us maybe some interpretation that he have. But what he has to do tonight is not just simply deny that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in the Bible because this is what he believes, but if he denies the proof that we're given, he has to show us if it's not the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then in fact, who does this prophecy refer to? And this has to be the case in every prophecy we mention that he attempts to reject. If you deny it being the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we ask you, who does this prophecy refer to? And if this prophecy was not fulfilled at all, then what he is doing is he's discrediting his Bible, because the Bible gives us standards of prophecy. It says that if someone speaks in the name of the Lord and it don't come true, then that person is not to be taken to be believed. So if there's a prophecy in the Bible, and he can't tell us exactly who this prophecy is about or point to it, and it hasn't been fulfilled, then we have to conclude that this prophecy is not fulfilled and the Bible is false. The next prophecy I want to go to is a prophecy in the book of Isaiah also. Isaiah chapter 42. Isaiah chapter 42. And it begins, "The servant of the Lord, here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen one, in whom I delight, and I will put my spirit on him." And when we look at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even in this first verse, we see all of these names are actually names of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He is my servant. The Prophet Muhammad said, I am Abdullah, the servant of Allah, whom I uphold, who God has chosen. And the Prophet name is also Mustafa. He's the one who's Mustafa, and whom I delight. And the Prophet name is also Habibullah, the beloved of Allah. I will put my spirit on him. The Quran tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the revelation to him through the angel Jibril, and he sent the angel Jibril upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. We know the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was known, and is reported about him in hadith that's authentic, that he was one that would not raise his voice in the marketplaces. He was not a loud, voiceless person. A bruised reed will he not break, and a smoldering wick would he not snuff out. In faithfulness, he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged. When we look at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let us finish, not be discouraged, till he establishes justice on earth, in his teaching, the islands will put their hope. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he preached his message, the people came to him and said, "Listen, cease from calling people to this message. We give you whatever you want. We give you fame. We give you wealth. We give you anything you ask for, but just stop this message." And he told them that you can give me the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left, but I will not stop preaching this message until I am called back by God. So we can see that he will not be discouraged till he establishes the justice on earth. And at the end, in the farewell khutbah of the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked, after he conveyed his final message, he asked his companions, he said, "Have I conveyed the message?" And they said, "You have conveyed the message." Allah revealed the verse in saying that this is the day that we have perfected for you your religion and completed our favor upon you. This is what God, the Lord, says, the creator of the heavens, who stretches them out, who spreads out the earth with all springs from it, who gives beneath it to his people all life, those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you to righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will take hold of your hand. I'm just moving the screen here, sorry. I, the Lord, called you to righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open the eyes of the blind, to free the captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon of those who sit in darkness. Is that the end?
You have 10 seconds.
Wow, subhanAllah. I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not yield my glory to another or my praise to idols. See the former things that have taken place, and new things that declare. MashaAllah. In fact, so it's 10 minutes or 15?
15. 15. All right, so let me mute you. Sorry, bro, but that's the rules, right, guys? Got to stick to the rules tonight. Unmute. Okay, Chris, can you hear me? Can you speak, Chris? Let me make sure.
Yeah, I can hear you, Jaws. Can you hear me good?
Okay. Yep, sound perfect. Okay, let me know when you're ready to begin.
All righty, go ahead, Jaws.
Okay, timer started.
So, God, give me the strength to deliver your message with accuracy and clarity. And I also pray that anyone who has this question we are talking about today, let them receive that answer today. And I also would pray that you be glorified, God, in having at least one come to Christ through this conversation today. And I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. So to get right into it here, I want to thank Aqil again for engaging into another discussion today, and as well as Ijaz for hosting the debate. I also want to thank everyone who is listening to this discussion today for giving up their time to listen to this debate. I also want to say Muslims adhere to the Torah being the books given to Moses, not the whole Old Testament. So any prophecies outside of this is irrelevant. I also want to say that I'm going to admit right now that Muhammad is prophesied in the Bible we have today, but not as Aqil would like to see. I believe Muhammad is prophesied as an antichrist, but never as a true prophet, which is the contention of this debate. Now, this is a very important topic, because if Muhammad is not prophesied in the Torah or the Injil as a prophet of God, then we could deduct from this that Muhammad is a liar, which I would say we can see a prophecy about this, and that is in 1 John chapter 2, verse 22. Who is the liar? It is whoever denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a person is the Antichrist, denying the Father and the Son. Now, also, there are some tests that Moses gave us to see if one is a true prophet of God. And we can appeal to this standard in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 to 22. And it says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your countrymen. You shall listen to him. This is according to all that you have asked of your Lord God in Horeb on the day of assembly, saying, 'Let me not hear again the voice of my Lord, Lord my God. Let me not see this great fire anymore, or I will die.' The Lord said to me, 'They have spoken well, and I will rise up a prophet from among their countrymen like you, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. It shall come about that whoever will not listen to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. But the prophet who speaks a word presumptuously in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or which he speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. You may say in your heart, how will we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not come about or come true, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. That prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You shall not be afraid of him." So we can determine if Muhammad said things that are not true, by Moses' standard, Muhammad would not be a true prophet. The other problem Aqil will have to deal with when quoting the Injil or the Quran is that he has to show that the Injil and Torah he is quoting has the same theology. As well, Aqil will have to demonstrate that Allah spoke directly to Muhammad, because this is a standard we see in Deuteronomy as well. So I'm going to quote Deuteronomy 34, chapter 10, or verses 10 to 12. "Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all his signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt, against Pharaoh and all his servants in the entire land, for all of the mighty deeds of all the terrifying displays of the power that Moses performed in the sight of all of Israel." Now just quote Numbers chapter 12, verse 68. He said, "Listen to my words. When there's a prophet among you, I, the Lord, reveal myself to them in visions. I speak to them in dreams. But this is not true of my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. With him, I speak face to face, clearly and not in riddles. He sees the form of Yahweh. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses?" So we can see here that Moses was given signs and wonders. Also, God spoke to Moses face to face, which the original wording is mouth to mouth. So let's see if Muhammad was like Moses in that aspect. But we can see from Islamic literature that Gabriel spoke with Muhammad, not God, quoting Surah 96, verse 1. Recite in the name of your Lord who created. Which brings up more problems, because if this is the first thing Gabriel said to him in the cave, which is what we read in the Hadith, how is it in Surah 96? Kind of weird to me. So we'll keep going. The Quran, chapter 28, verse 48. "But when the truth came to them from us, they said, 'Why has he not given like that which he's given to Moses?' Did they not disbelieve in that which was given to Moses before? They said, 'They are but two works of magic supporting each other. And indeed, we are both disbelievers.'" So we can see here in the verse in the Quran that Muhammad did not do the signs and wonders like Moses because he said, well, they didn't believe it. And in it, anyways, as well as we know that Allah has not entered his creation from what Muslims believe. So therefore, it would be impossible for Allah to speak face to face with Muhammad. So that is another criteria Muhammad fails upon. I will even go so far to say when Aqil quotes any of these references from our Bible, she's showing that Muhammad is a false prophet, and of course, not like Moses. And one more thing I want to look into if Muhammad was like Moses, and this is to deal with who God is to his creation. So first off, Muhammad believed Allah was a father to no one. And I will go even as far to say that Muhammad taught that the closest relationship we could possibly have with Allah is that of a servant to master relationship. And we can see this reference in Surah 19:92. There is no one in the heavens and the earth that he comes to the most merciful as a servant. And Surah chapter 5, verse 18. But the Jews and the Christians say, we are children of Allah and his beloved. Say then, why does he punish you for your sins? Rather, you are human beings. So Muhammad is refuting the claim of the Jews and the Christians that they are children of God. But again, this goes against the very theology Moses taught. And we can look for references and say Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 1. It says, you are the children of Yahweh, your God. Deuteronomy 32:6 says, is this the way you repay your Lord, you foolish and unwise people? Is he not your father, your creator, who made you and formed you? And as well, to finish it off with Deuteronomy 32:18-20. Of the rock that beget thee, thou art mindful, and hast forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them, and I will see that their end shall be for they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. So we can see clearly that Muhammad refuted the notion that Allah had any spiritual children, and Moses affirms that, yes, we are the spiritual children of God. So as I said before, if Aqil wants to appeal to the Torah to prove Muhammad is prophesied in there, he is shooting himself in the foot. Because the prophet, like Moses, would not have complete opposite theology from what Moses had. Now, this is only half of the argument as well. When we talk about the Torah, we are talking about the first five books of Moses. And Muslims will say the Torah has been corrupted, and the only way we can tell what is not corrupted and what is corrupted is what the Quran affirms. So Aqil will have to identify the verses he is quoting today is a part of the original Torah and not this corrupted Torah Muslims seem to think exists. Now the next part of the debate is the Injil, which is the revelation given to Jesus. This is where the conversation is going to get even more interesting. Muslims always affirm that the gospel according to John is not the Injil or any other gospel. I actually remember a debate with Shadid Lewis and Bob Segal where Shadid Lewis had said, Muhammad is not in this book, right? He's not in this book, right? Now he's holding the Bible in the air and then said, well, this is not the Injil. So I'm wondering if Aqil takes the same view as what another Muslim apologist has already stated. Also, if Muslims want to quote the New Testament, they have to provide evidence the New Testament is the Injil, which will be hard for them considering this. Quran 16:36 says, and verily we have sent among every ummah, which is community or nation, a messenger proclaiming, worshiping Allah alone and avoid or keep away from Taghut, which is false deities. Do not worship Taghut beside Allah. Do not worship false deities besides Allah. And also we have in Surah 14:4, and we have sent no messenger save with the tongue of his people, that he might make all clear to them that God leads astray. So we can deduct from the verses in the Quran that Allah sends a messenger to every nation to avoid Taghut. And when he sends the messenger speaks the language of that nation. So if Muslims want to attribute any New Testament verse to this Injil, then Aqil must provide evidence that Jesus was Greek, was a Greek prophet sent to the Roman nation. Because the very verses he's appealing to in the New Testament to show Muhammad is prophesied is originally written in Greek. And we have manuscripts to provide evidence of this. Why is this important? Because Muslims will say Jesus was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. And on top of that, they would say Jesus spoke Aramaic or Hebrew. So if Muslims want to quote this Injil given to Jesus, they must present it from the Hebrew or Aramaic. And it must be contemporary to the time of Jesus. Unless Aqil admits that the New Testament cannot be the Injil by the criteria of his own Quran, which is his ultimate standard. Now, last but not least, there is usually a prophecy about Muhammad mentioned in Deuteronomy 33:2. But let's look at it for a second. Now, remember, Aqil must present this is from the original Torah and not a part of the corrupted Torah. But if he can, then we can consider the following. And Moses said, the Lord came from Sinai and rose up from Seir unto them, and he shined forth from Mount Paran, and he came with a myriad of saints. From his right hand went a fiery law for them. So this verse is identifying Yahweh as the figure being mentioned. So I would have to ask Aqil, do you believe Muhammad is God? If so, then maybe you could apply this verse to him. But if not, then applying this verse to Muhammad is detrimental to the Islamic worldview. Example, if Aqil asserts this can only be Muhammad, then he must show from Islamic literature where Muhammad is equated with Allah. Once Aqil does this to substantiate his point in Deuteronomy 33:2, he has then committed shirk. So I doubt Aqil will want to argue that this is in fact Muhammad. Next, Aqil will focus on within the verse, even though he is committing shirk, is saying Muhammad came with 10,000 companions to fulfill this prophecy. But I would say, wait, whoa, back up the bus a bit. The Hebrew word there that is translated for 10,000 in this verse simply means multitude, as in to say a lot, not a specific number. So to equate the 10,000 to this verse is basically begging the question. So to conclude my opening, I would say that no, Muhammad is not prophesied in the Torah and the Injil as a prophet of God. The part I would say he may be able to point to Muhammad is in 1 John chapter 2, verse 22, which says, who is the liar? It is whoever denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a person is the Antichrist, denying the Father and the Son. So as I said at the start, I believe Muhammad is prophesied in the Bible, but he is not prophesied as a true prophet. He is prophesied as a liar and as an antichrist. How much time do I have left, Ejaz?
1 minute and 30 seconds.
Okay, I can cut it off there, sir.
Okay, no problem. I'll stop it. Okay, so next we have the rebuttals. Chris, just one. You mentioned the word tag. It's not tag hot. It's tagut. Like you're trying to say the word "ook" and tuk, that might be difficult, but it's not tag hot like Pizza Hut. For a second there, you caught me off guard, man. Just to let everyone else know, I thought tonight we would get less than 30 people, but we're up to 29, almost the exact same number we had yesterday. And I would just like to give a special welcome to Sam Shimoon. He's in the room tonight, so hope you're doing well, Sam. Okay, so let me get things rolling. Aqil, let me know when you're ready, please. Spotlight, there we go. You're welcome, Sam. Nice to see you again. Okay, Aqil, let me know when you're ready. You have a 7-minute rebuttal to do, okay?
Okay, you can go.
Okay, 1 second, and you may start now.
Okay, so now the time took upon us last time when it just finished this and didn't get to the points that Chris made in his opening statement. And quickly, it seems that his opening statement was not much relevant to what I said, but maybe more so what he thought I was going to say. But I guess he would deal with my points when he gets to his first rebuttal. So continuing with Isaiah 42, starting at verse 10, it says, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the ends of the earth. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the ends of the earth. You who go down the sea and all that is in it, you islands and all who live in them, let the wilderness and its towns raise their voices. Let the settlements where Kedar lives rejoice. Let the people of Salet sing for joy. Let them shout from the mountaintops. Let them give glory to the Lord and proclaim his praise in the islands. The Lord will march out like a champion, like a warrior. He will stir up his zeal with a shout. He will raise the battle cry, and he will triumph over his enemies. And it goes on. And I think that we can stop here because our time, again, is short. But when we look at this prophecy in Isaiah 42, it says, let the Lord sing a new song. A new song is what? A new people giving the honor of God Almighty. And it goes on, it says that let the wilderness and its towns raise their voices, let the settlements where Kedar lives rejoice. Who is Kedar? Kedar is the second son of Ishmael, of Abraham, and of Ishmael. Ishmael is the father of the Arabs. And we also read before in Isaiah 21 about Arabia, the prophecy about Arabia. So we find here, God is mentioning Kedar, let them rejoice. Let the people of Kedar rejoice. Let the people of Salet, the people of Salet. Some people say Salat, but it's actually Salet. I look up the word Arabic, it's Salet. Let the people of Salet sing for joy. Who is Salet? The people of Salet. Salet is a mountain in Medina. And this is clear. So we have God saying the people of Kedar will rejoice in their settlements, and the people of Salet will sing for joy. Where? Let them shout from the mountaintops. So this is a clear identification of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And we go on and look at this prophecy in Isaiah 42, which we can't do justice to because of time constraints. But if God is saying that he will give, let the people sing a new song, a new people that will take on the message of God and take on the covenant of God. God promised Abraham, Isaac, and Ishmael that they would have a great nation, all three of them. The Christians will say, yes, God gave Abraham that promise, and God gave Isaac that promise. But where's the promise to Ishmael? The promise to Ishmael is the Arabs, and from the Arabs is the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We have to compensate for this. Where is the promise that God gave to Ishmael? Why is God saying that the people of Kedar rejoice in their settlements and let them sing from the mountaintops of Salet, a place in Medina? We have to answer for this prophecy. Now, let me cover some points that Chris made, because I don't want to go too much more into that. I want to begin to address some of the points he made. He mentioned Deuteronomy 18:18 as a litmus test of who a prophet is and who a prophet isn't. And when we look at the life of Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, mentions that God said, I will raise him up from your brethren, one likened to Moses, one likened to you. When we look at the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of all the people that came after him, there's no one more like the Prophet Muhammad than Moses, or vice versa. There's no one more like Moses than the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And if this prophecy in Deuteronomy 18:18, which I didn't mention, is not about the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to carefully examine it and see exactly who does it fit. But for sure, it doesn't fit Jesus. It doesn't fit Jesus, because you believe Jesus is God. And according to the prophecy, it says that God will put his words into his mouth. Into whose mouth? Into the mouth of Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah sent the angel Jibril with the revelation of God to Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he dictated verbatim. So the words of the Quran are the exact words of God, not the words of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So this is clearly saying that Allah put the words, his words, into the mouth of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We can look at some of the prophecies the Prophet mentioned that came to pass. He mentioned certain events that will happen, and they're coming. And you know, time doesn't allow us to go into all the prophecies, but I give you one prophecy. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said that, and one of the signs of the time is that you will have naked herdsmen, that they, in any time, barefooted, naked herdsmen, they will compete for building of tall buildings. And what you see now in Arabia, these same people who used to be desert camel herders or lamb herders, they're now competing for the vying of making tall buildings. There's people here make a tall building. They say, I want my building to be taller. This is actually competition that the Prophet Muhammad SAW mentioned over 1,400 years ago. Just to mention one. In the Quran, Allah says about Fir'aun, when he says that on this day, I will save your body so that you can be a sign for those who come later. According to history and science and the museums, there's a mummified figure of a pharaoh who they claim to be the pharaoh of the time of Moses, intact. And God says, I will say this day, I will save you in your body so you can be a sign to those who come later. So here it is, the Quran is mentioning not only the event of Pharaoh, but saying that the body will be remained and saved. And today it's on display to show that the Quran, in fact, was true. So these are just some of the things the Prophet Muhammad SAW mentioned or from revelation or from inspiration about prophecies in the future. Refuting the idea that Christians are the children of God. Allah mentioned the idea that the Christians and the Jews are children of God because they took this title as if somehow they're free from punishment. Like we're God's children and we're absolved from punishment because we're special. And God is saying that if you're so special, then why does God punish you? And no, the Quran and Islam does not, as to refute the idea of ideology, does not appeal to the idea of father. But this was something that was given to the people before, that's fine. In Isaiah 42, it says, let them sing a new song. So in Arabic, we don't have this idea of Ab, but we have the idea of Rab. And Rab means a nourisher, a cherisher, a sustainer, one that nurtures and brings up. So even though it may encompass this idea of Ab, we don't call God the Father because the terminology has become distorted. And if Chris admits that the children of Israel are the sons of God with an S, then why is Jesus so special as being the Son of God? If God has many sons,
okay, Aqil,
what's so special about Jesus?
Aqil.
Yes.
Your time's up. Time's okay. Up.
All right.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Let me mute you. Okay. We go back to our friend Chris. Okay. Chris, let me know when you are ready. You have 7 minutes. Okay.
Yep. Go ahead. You can start now.
Okay. It started.
Yeah, so first off, I don't know if Aqil actually understands the topic that we're debating or not today. The topic is Muhammad prophesied about in the Injil and Torah? The last time I checked, when I looked at the Quran, the Torah is the book that was given to Moses, not the book that was given to Isaiah. So every prophecy that he's brought up is irrelevant to the discussion today. Now, he said that the Torah is the first 5 books of Moses, and I agree with you. Another part in his opening statement, he said the Torah is the whole Old Testament. No, it's not. And can you give me one serious scholar that says that? Because I believe that they would say that the Old Testament is a compilation of the Torah and the Tanakh. Torah and Tanakh. They are two separate words meaning two different things. And so he also started to elaborate on the 4 gospels as what we could say is the Injil. But again, there was nothing there. There's no prophecy from the Injil in Aqil's opening statement, and there was no prophecy from the Torah in his opening statement. So he goes to Isaiah 21. He goes to verses 5 to 17. My response to this, Aqil, is it is irrelevant. Until you can identify Isaiah is given the Torah from the Quran. And of course, the second prophecy from Isaiah is not Moses again. It's irrelevant unless you can provide evidence that the book that was given to Isaiah is the Torah. Now, this is going to be a little rough because I'm not really sure what Aqil was trying to do, if he was just trying to avoid the actual conversation because he realizes himself that Muhammad is not prophesied in the Torah and the Injil. So I just want to run over a few things that he has mentioned. They are kind of irrelevant, though. He goes to Isaiah. Now, in Isaiah 53, the servant dies for our sins. In Isaiah 63:16 and 64:8, Yahweh is Israel's father. All of this refutes Muhammad. So why are you going to the book of Isaiah when Isaiah, being a prophet, identifies Yahweh as the father of Israel? Isaiah also identifies in Isaiah 53 the servant would die. And it gets worse. We can go to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9. Or Isaiah 6 to 7. A child born who is called El Gabor, the mighty God. So Isaiah, being a monotheistic Jew, has said, well, I'll quote Isaiah chapter 9 and Isaiah chapter 10. So in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 to 7, he talks about a child being born, a son being given. Gives him the title of El Gabor, which means the mighty God. Just one chapter further, this monotheistic Jew, Isaiah, actually identifies Yahweh, the Father. This is in Isaiah chapter 10, verses 20 to 21. He actually identifies Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel, as El Gabor. Now, this again is something that Muhammad would reject. Muhammad would reject that any human being could be called the mighty God. And also, Aqil was trying to say that this prophecy is talking about Kedar. I would have to, even though it's irrelevant, I would actually ask Aqil to try to demonstrate and to prove that Muhammad is actually from Kedar. I would actually put out there is no evidence for this assertion from Aqil. Now, just to wrap up a little bit, because there wasn't really much to address, it's kind of a, I was kind of hoping for a lot more, actually, Aqil. But I'm going to state this at the end. God the Father can put the words into God the Son. We can see this in John chapter 8, verses 28 to 29, John chapter 12, verses 47 to 50, and John chapter 14, verse 31. So let's just go over what I've said here. So the only thing that Aqil has actually done is he's abandoned the actual debate topic, because I believe that he actually believes himself that Muhammad is not prophesied in the Injil and or the Torah. This is why we have not got one prophecy that Aqil has been able to demonstrate today. Instead, he goes to Isaiah to try to present a prophecy about Muhammad. But when he does this, he shoots himself in the foot. The reason for this is Isaiah didn't hold to the same theology as what Muhammad did. So why are you appealing to a prophet that does not hold to the same theology? As I said before, Isaiah, being a monotheistic Jew, believed that the son that was going to be given named him El Gabor. The very next chapter names Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel, as El Gabor. Also, Isaiah in 63:16 and 64:8, Isaiah names Yahweh as Israel's father. And in Isaiah 53, the servant dies for our sins. All of this Muhammad rejects. So I'm wondering how he can go to a prophet that rejects the very theology that he's trying to appeal to. And my time's up, Ejaz. Thank you.
You have 30 seconds left if you want to continue.
I'm good, sir.
Okay, all right, that's it. Okay, thank you for your presentation, your response, Chris. Let me just get Aqil here. Okay, Aqil, you'll have a 5-minute rebuttal, okay? 5 minutes. Let me know when to begin.
You can begin.
It started.
Okay, bismillah. Okay, first, Chris asked me to bring one serious scholar who says that the Torah is the Old Testament. I bring you one better than a scholar, Chris. I bring you Jesus himself. In the New Testament, Jesus quotes the law. He says the law, but he's talking about two different references. So I asked you to open up in John 10:34, where Jesus quotes and he says it's the law, but he quotes Psalms. And then also in 15:25, John 15:25, he also mentions the law, and he quotes Isaiah. So we have John 10:34, where Jesus says the law, the Torah, and he's quoting Psalms. And then also in John 15, 25, he said quoting the law, and he's quoting Isaiah. So you ask me for a scholar, I bring you your Lord who said that the Torah can be synonymous also with Psalms and Isaiah. And I hope I satisfied that question. As from a Muslim perspective in general, not only does Allah mention that the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is mentioned in the Torah or the Injil, but also if you go into Quran verse 3, Surah 3, verse 81, it says, if you call, O people of the scripture, when Allah took the covenant of the prophets in general, not just from the Torah or the Injil, but when he took the covenant from the prophets in general, saying, whatever I give you of the scripture and wisdom, and then there comes to you a messenger confirming what is with you, you must believe in him and support him. This is Quran chapter 3, verses 81. So not only the Torah or the Injil, but also the Allah says that when to the prophets, he took a covenant that when he sent to him a messenger, you must confirm him and believe him. So your argument, your premise just comes from your lack of ignorance about the position of Islam on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But also the Torah, the Injil, we see Jesus quoting and saying the law, yet he's not quoting from the first five books that was given to Moses alayhi salam. He's quoting from Psalms and also Isaiah, who I'm quoting from. Now, in terms of the Tanakh, correct me if I'm wrong, Chris, but you said the Tanakh is somehow different from the Torah. The Tanakh, I believe, is an acronym that encompasses the three sections of the Old Testament, the Torah, the books of the prophets, and also another section like stories and stuff like that. So if this is the case, then you're saying that the Tanakh and the Torah is somehow divided in two. Maybe this is just something that you don't understand. Man equated with God in Deuteronomy 33. I think we dealt with that before. In the Bible, we dealt some of this yesterday. The Bible uses the word God as a representative for himself. He calls Moses Elohim. So is Moses God? Do you worship Moses? So we can't take these words and start playing and cherry picking and say, oh, here, do you worship, think Muhammad is God, and that's committing shirk and stuff like that. I think this is just playing games. Also, the corrupt scripture. I mentioned in my premise, the Muslim's position is that we believe God gave revelation to the previous prophets, but we also believe that those revelations were corrupted and manipulated. So because of that, the only way for us to know for sure exactly what is from God and what's not from God is to use the Quran as that criteria to show what is consistent with the message of God from the beginning of time and what's not consistent. So we can use the Quran as a criteria, as it's called Al-Furqan, to know what's true and what's not true. Also, on this point, the Bible says Jesus went out and preached the gospel. Now, Chris went on some tangent about the Quran says everybody to their languages, and Jesus was wrote to the Romans. This is the fallacy of the Christians, not our fault, that you wrote your books and the first writing of them was in the language of Jesus. But Jesus preached the gospel. Where's that gospel that Jesus preached? You have to answer that question if you want to tackle this idea of Jesus preaching the gospel. I believe my time is up. And
no, you have a minute. That was the first spell.
Oh, okay, great. So, Jesus said, I was sent to the people of Israel. So this was his words himself. Now, Chris does a lot of damage control, which he mentions in the verse that's a conflict for him ahead of time to try to somehow get the pressure off of him. But we're going to mention it again. Jesus' words was, I was sent to the people of Israel. So if you use that verse in the Quran about God sending a message to every people in their language, then Jesus was sent to who? The people of Israel. It just happened to be historically your people wrote the book in a language that wasn't the language of Jesus. And this has been a problem from the very beginning up until now that you don't even know the true language of Jesus. The New Testament contains nothing of Jesus in the initial language except when he's on the cross. My God, why have thou forsaken me? This is the only words that remain of Jesus' language in the New Testament. Why did you keep this and not everything else?
Okay, that's time. That's time. Okay, so you've had your second 5-minute rebuttal, Aqil. Now it's time for Chris's 5-minute rebuttal. Chris, can you just test the audio?
Hello, Ijaz. You hear me still?
Sounding perfect, Chris. Let me know when to start.
You can start now. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over what he's been saying, and I'm going to start from the last and go to the start. So basically, he started saying that Jesus, we don't even know what language Jesus spoke. It would have either been Hebrew or Aramaic. So, Aqil, are you trying to say that the Quran quotes Jesus in a language he never spoke? Because Jesus never spoke the Quraishi Arabic. Bad argument, sir. And then he tries to say that Jesus, that we say Jesus, was only sent to the lost sheep of Israel. But in Matthew chapter 10, verses 17 and 18, and Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, that same Jesus says that his disciples will go to the Gentiles. Do we read the whole thing, Aqil? All right, so he quoted Surah 381, and it says, confirming the scriptures they possessed. But the only scripture that was around at Muhammad's time to confirm was that what we have today. We call it the Holy Bible, which Muslims reject. So what was it actually going to confirm? And also, the Holy Bible is God's word, and Muhammad contradicts the theology of the Bible. Why are you even trying to appeal to it, Aqil? It makes no sense to me when your prophet has a whole different theology than what the New Testament and or the Torah and Tanakh are saying. Why are you even appealing to it to try to prove that your prophet is in there? And you also said that the Bible can apply the name of God to other people. I would also say to you, Aqil, do you not adhere to Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat? That is attributing the most beautiful names of Allah to himself and not to creation? Well, if you do, then you just called Muhammad a liar. Or so if you don't, you've just called Muhammad a liar. Since Muhammad said you cannot give any of God's name to anyone besides God. Because if you do, this is shirk. So are you committing shirk today, Aqil? Or are you going to take back what you've already said? So when you go to the Bible to prove your case, the Bible actually condemns Muhammad. As I said, he went to John. So I'm going to go to John as well. John chapter 2, verse 22, it states, who is the liar? It is whoever denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a person is the Antichrist, denying the Father and the Son. We can see that the Quran denies that Allah has any children at all. Muhammad denies that Jesus is the Christ. To Muhammad, Jesus is just a messenger, and God has no spiritual children at all. So by the standard that Aqil's been laying out for us, we can actually deduct from this, if he wants to quote John, that Muhammad is a liar, because Muhammad denies the Father and the Son. And again, I just want to point out as well that this debate is actually supposed to be, is Muhammad prophesied in the Injil and Torah? And what I want everybody to do in the audience is, how many prophecies of the Injil did we hear? I say none. And how many prophecies from Moses, which was given the Torah, have we heard? Again, I would say none. So Aqil has not given a positive case today for Muhammad being prophesied in the Torah and or the Injil. So I would ask Aqil the question today. Are you willing to say that you've lost this debate because you cannot present any evidence from the Torah or the Injil that Muhammad actually was prophesied within? That's my time, Ijaz. Thank you.
Yeah, 15 seconds left if you want to take it.
I'm good, sir.
Okay, so that ends the second rebuttal there. Okay, do you guys want to take a minute break and return for the cross-examination?
I'm all right, Aqil.
What about you, Aqil? Do you want to take a 1 minute break?
Yeah, 1 minute break is fine. I'll take 1 minute break.
Okay, we'll take a 1 minute break, guys, okay? Just reminding the audience that we do have some feedback forms here and some debate proposal forms. Please fill them out. It does not collect any personal information. We simply want to provide a good service to everyone who is interested in apologetics debates. Sam, I think the last form might be very useful for you. Hopefully you fill it out. So you just take a 1 minute break. There is a change in the format for the debate tonight. We will be doing a 10-minute cross-examination, not a 15-minute cross-examination. Tonight, Brother Aqil will go first with his cross-examination questions. Okay, Aqil and Chris, just give me the thumbs up when you're ready to go. Okay, both of you have it. Okay, Aqil will be asking the questions. Okay. All right, the timer is set. Both of you have been unmuted. We just have one reminder. When the questioner asks the question, you answer. When the answerer has, the answerer cannot ask questions of the person asking the questions. Just to not have a repeat of yesterday. Okay, guys. Okay, Aqil, your time begins now.
Okay, Bismillah. All right, Chris, in John chapter 10, verse 34, it says, Jesus answered them, "Is it not written in your law, I said ye are gods?" Jesus quoting the scripture. Where is this at in the scripture?
Sure. It's in Psalms.
So is Jesus equating the law with Psalms?
But I would like for you to,
Is Jesus equating the law with Psalms?
Psalms is not the Torah, sir.
So why did Jesus call it the Torah? He said, is it not written in your law, the Torah? Is it not written in your law, ye are gods? Jesus called Psalms the law, Torah.
In the verse, does Jesus identify the Psalms as the Torah itself?
He's quoting Psalms, and he says, is it not written in your law? I say you are gods. He's quoting Psalms. You just admitted to that. Jesus calls Psalms the Torah.
Okay, but I would look at it this way. If you're saying the law could only be the Torah, then you say that the law is in the Quran, so therefore the Quran is the Torah as well. The New Testament is the Torah as well. That's not giving any response. What Muhammad actually said and what Allah has actually said within the Quran, which you adhere to, sir, is that the Torah is given to Moses.
You asked me for one scholar that said that the Torah and the Old Testament is synonymous. I'm giving you your Lord and Savior who quoted Psalms and called it the Torah. I'm establishing something here, that the Torah also can have a generic meaning, and I mentioned that in my beginning. So yeah. Let's go on, because I see that you're not answering this question.
Well, what I would say, nowhere in the Quran does it say the Torah refers to the Old Testament.
I'm not asking about the Quran. I asked you, in the Bible, Jesus quoted Psalms, and he called it the Torah. You confirmed. Let's move on. In John 15... John chapter 15, verse 25, Jesus says, "But this comes to pass that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law, that they hated me without a cause." Jesus said that they written in their law, they hated me without a cause. He's quoting something from the old scripture. Can you tell me what verse he's quoting and what book, the book that's in the Bible?
Yeah, again, since the debate is about the Quran and its uses of the language, I would actually state that there's nowhere in the Quran where it says that Torah refers to any of the books in the Old Testament.
I'm not asking that, Chris.
The Quran identifies the Torah as the books given to Moses.
You're red herring. I'm asking you, in the Bible, Jesus is quoting old scripture, and he called it the law. So in this particular verse, Jesus says that is written in their law, they hated me for no reason. I'm asking you, do you know what verse he's quoting and what book in the Bible he's quoting from the Old Scripture?
Yeah, and like I've said, to
okay,
me,
listen, I'll help you. I'll help you because you're not answering.
Not the Injil according to me.
Okay.
In your Quran, it actually states that the Torah is the book given to Moses.
Okay.
But you're actually trying to use a corrupted source to prove your point coming from a Muslim worldview? That doesn't make sense to me.
In this verse, do you recognize this verse as being in Isaiah? Do you recognize this verse that's quoted by Jesus where he says that you have hated me for no reason? Can you recognize and identify this as being in the book of Isaiah? Yes or no? It's a question.
Yep. It's irrelevant to the conversation today, sir. As I've said numerous amounts of times, the Torah is described in your Quran as the books given to Moses.
I'm establishing the fact that even though Allah calls the books that's given to Moses the Torah has a general application, and I'm giving you evidence from your own Bible that you are refusing to accept from Jesus, your Lord and Savior. Jesus called Psalms Torah. Jesus called Isaiah Torah.
So the problem is that you don't even accept everything that John has said. John is not Muhammad, and in the book of John, Jesus is God. Do you accept everything that John, you would not accept everything that John says. So why are you trying to substantiate your point and cherry pick back and forth?
Okay, let us move to the next point because I see that we're not getting anywhere here. There's places in the Bible where it's quoted as saying in the scripture, but we don't find these words in the scripture. And let me help you where I'm going. I'm going to show you that in the Bible, there's things that's missing. Even though it's called the Torah or the NGO, and even though it's missing books, God still calls it the Torah and NGO. And I'll give you an example. If you have a piece, a whole cake, and you take a piece of two or three out, what remains is still called the cake, even though it's missing something from it. So even though the Torah is missing all of it because it was tampered or misappropriated, God still calls it the Torah. Even though the NGO of Esau is missing things, God still calls it the Injil as a convenience, you know what I'm saying, and an honor for the book. It's still called that. But in the Bible, there's places where Jesus and other people are quoting and say, in the scripture, yet when you go to the scripture, it's never found. And I'll just give you one example. In the book of Jude, or if you
remember, hey, Aqil, are you asking me a question, or are you just going to take the 10 minutes and respond?
No, I'm leading to the question, so you're going to understand my point. In the book of Jude, are you familiar with the book of Jude?
That is not a part of the Torah, sir, especially in the Quran. The Torah is the book given to Moses.
The Jude is in the New Testament, is it not?
You're a Muslim and you adhere to the Quran. And in the Quran,
Jude is in the New Testament, Chris, is it not? Moses. Is Jude in the New Testament?
As I said before, this debate is about, is Muhammad prophesied in the Injil and the Torah?
You filibustering, Chris. You refuse to answer.
The Torah is given to Moses. The Injil is given to Jesus.
Okay. Since you don't want to answer the question, in Jude chapter 1, verse 13, it quotes the book of Enoch. Is the book of Enoch in the Bible?
So what you're doing is, so if there's missing books,
answer the question, Chris, please?
Can I answer the question, or are you just going to keep jumping in when I talk, sir? You're going to let me? Excellent. So if there's missing books, then why are you using a corrupt source to try to prove your prophet? If it's corrupted, then this means your prophet is corrupt, since he needs a corrupt source to prove him. And so much for Quran 18:27, which says none of Allah's words can ever be lost.
Chris, I'm asking you a question about the topic and you refuse to answer, and then you want to accuse me of stuff that's got nothing to do with the topic.
I'm
establishing a point in this cross-examination, so I'm trying to do it in the form of a question. Now, back to the question, the book of Jude, is it the New Testament? Is it not? Yes or no?
You would actually have to provide evidence that this is from the Torah that was given to Moses from your Quran, sir.
I said New Testament. The New Testament is in the New Testament, correct? I'm asking about the book of Jude in the New Testament for the 10th time. Book of Jude in the New Testament?
Can you identify that Jude is the Injil that was given to Jesus.
In the beginning of my opening, I said conveniently we refer to the New Testament as the Injil. So maybe you're not following, and maybe you have a script that you're reading, and it's not applicable or practical to the conversation, because it appears you hear anything I'm saying to you. The book of Jude.
Well, if you want to, I didn't really want to indulge in red herrings, but since you want to appeal to the book of Jude, God revealed to Jude a prophecy, and Jude says that Jesus is the Lord that comes to judge evildoers, all of which Muhammad rejects. So to use Jude as a witness against Muhammad. So I'm wondering why you would even use that.
If you answer the question, I can show you why I get there. Let me move on, because what you're doing is you're filibustering and you're killing my cause for your time. I was hoping that you would answer the questions so we can get to my point, but you dance around the whole time and didn't answer anything, which is proof against you, because I'm trying to establish a point using your sources and you refuse to accept them. I quoted you Jesus and you tell me to make
on. You're trying to make a point outside of the actual debate topic, and that's
No, it's not. It's relevant. It's all relevant. It's all relevant. You have to, in order to fulfill prophecy, you have to bring from different sources and places to make, you know, sense out of what's being prophesied about.
Is this your question for me? Is this just another rebuttal?
Oh, okay, Chris. When I ask you the question, you don't answer it. Then when I have to explain what I'm trying to talk about, you want to ask me, am I doing a rebuttal?
Well, I want to make it relevant to the topic, sir.
Did Jesus quote Psalms and Isaiah and call it the Torah? Yes or no?
He called it the law. He didn't call it the Torah, sir.
What does it say in the actual language, the Torah, the law? What is the law?
Last time I checked, Jesus is not Muhammad, and he's not the Quran, so.
Okay.
Okay, is that time? Yeah. Okay, that's 10 minutes gone. Okay, guys, just a message to both of you. I don't mean to be rude or to sound judgmental, but stick to the question and answer format, please. Someone ask a question, answer. But it's an answering. Please make the question. Please answer the question. Make it relevant. Whether you think it does not belong to the topic or not, that's for the moderator to decide. Okay, guys? So this goes for both Aqil and both Chris. The moderator will step in if he thinks that the debate has gone off topic. Okay, guys?
Yeah, I don't have right. to.
So now I believe it.
Oh, sir.
Say that again, Chris?
Yeah, I don't have to address something that's a red herring to the discussion, though, sir.
Yep, that's your... You're free to do that. I'm just talking to both of you, saying that both of you were kind of going off the trail there, okay? So stick to the topic, please, guys, both of you, okay? I have to make Aqil the spotlight and Chris, okay. Chris, please let me know when you're ready. And just for the chat, I will emphasize, please, no name calling, especially towards both debaters. You will be kicked from the room for that behavior, okay? So, Chris, and let me know when you're ready to go.
Yeah, I'm ready to go.
Okay, and time has started.
So, Aqil, can you show me, in the Quran, is the Torah the books given to Moses?
I quoted you chapter 3, verse 81, where God makes a general statement talking about the prophets and saying that he made a covenant with all the prophets. And as I mentioned to you, the example of what Allah, you know, refers to the Torah, he refers it to in a generic sense, but we know also that the Torah was given to Moses. So okay. it applies to Moses specifically, but in a generic sense, it can apply to scripture, as in 381 shows that God says to all the prophets when my messenger comes and he's prophesied about. So
Aqil, can you show me where the word Torah is in Surah 381?
No, the word Torah is not in 381.
So you're saying that what you're saying, the word isn't actually there. You're just assuming it then.
No, we have a usage of the word Torah in the Quran that refers to the first five books or the books that was given to Moses, peace be upon him.
So we also have, actually states the Torah is the first five books given to Moses then, right?
Yes.
So then why would you try to say Isaiah is a part of the Torah when it goes against what your prophet actually said?
No, it doesn't go against. It's the usage, but we also identify Torah as being a generic for the Old Testament as well. We accept that. So because, and you should accept it also because Jesus said it himself. Jesus quoted Isaiah and he called Isaiah Torah. Jesus quoted Psalms and he called Psalms Torah. So we look at the Old Testament in general, it could be applied specifically to the five books or in general to the whole Old Testament.
Yeah, so again, Jesus is not Muhammad, sir. But can you show me where Torah is used in a generic sense in your Quran?
In a generic sense, I gave you verse 381, where God said all the prophets, it doesn't mention the word Torah, but it's also including that the prophecy of God is in all of the books of the Bible, or whatever so, came to the previous prophets.
So can you, since you're saying that it's using Torah in the general sense, can you show me where in Surah 381 it actually identifies the Torah then? Or are you just making this up? Are you adding words to the Quran, sir?
You already asked me that question. I told you that the word Torah is not in the 381.
But you're adding words to it then, sir, right?
No. What is in 381 is also God states clearly, and maybe you didn't read 381, God states clearly that he took a covenant with all the prophets, all of the prophets, that when a messenger come to them, that they support him and believe in him and support him. So, because God has declared also in 381, and we believe that the Quran is the explanation of the Quran. So, God gave revelation to the people before. He called it the Torah. He called it the Zabor. He called it the scripture. And in that scripture, he said the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is prophesied about. It's clear from 381. When we look at the Bible, we find that in the Torah, as well as outside of the first five books of New Testament, the Old Testament.
All right, so what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to read the surah and the verse. It says, fine. When Allah had made his covenant with the prophets, he said, behold that which I have given you of the scriptures and knowledge, and afterward they will come unto you a messenger confirming that which ye possess. Ye shall believe in him and ye shall help him. He said, do you agree and will ye take up my burden? They answered, we agree. He said, then bear ye witness. I will be a witness unto you. It doesn't say he's mentioned in the scriptures. And who's this prophet that will come and confirm the scriptures?
Okay, so before you mention, and you did it maybe in a sarcastic manner, that the Quran mentions the Torah and Injil, what remains with you? What remains with you? You have the same verbiage in this verse of what remains with you. It's the same verbiage you quoted from about the Torah trying to deny the premise. So you tried to isolate the Torah and the Injil by saying what remains with you. And here in verse 381, you just read it, it says what remains with you. The Quran is the explanation of the Quran.
Do you have Surah 157 with you, sir? Do you know what that is?
Say again?
Can you tell us what Surah 157 says, sir?
There's no Surah 157. There's only 114 surahs in the Quran.
Surah 7. 157.
Yes, so 7157, yes.
It should say, those who follow the messenger, the prophet who can neither read nor write, whom they find described in the Torah and the gospel, which are with them, he will enjoin on them which is right and forbid them which is wrong. But he will make lawful for them all good things and prohibit from them all the foul. And he will relieve them from their burden and the fetters that they used to wear. Those who believe in him and honor him and help him and follow the light which is sent down with him, they are successful. There it says he is mentioned in the Torah and the gospel. But Surah 381 says nothing about him being in all those scriptures of the prophets.
Okay, so if you read 381 again, as you read it, say, what is with him? If you read it, because the Quran has different names also for different books, it gives them different names. The Quran is called Quran, it's called Furqan, it's called Huda, it's called Nur. So God interchangeably used different names for those books. But as a generic sense, we don't have a problem. And I told you this, we agree that you can use generically Torah for the Old Testament in totality. But please, if you can read 381 again, make the correlation and use the same exact verbiage. Which you have with you, that which is revealed, what is with you. You read it in 157, you read it in 81.
Yeah, just
when Allah made his covenant with the prophets, he said, behold that which I have given you of the scriptures and the knowledge, and afterward there will come unto you a messenger. Remember, and afterward there will come unto you a messenger confirming that which ye possess.
Exactly.
Believe in him, and ye shall help him. And he said, do you agree, and you will, and will ye take up my burden, which I lay upon you in this matter? They answered, we agree. He said, then bear ye witnesses. I will be a witness to you. So, yes, he confirms the scriptures that are with them. Not that he...
What are those scriptures? What are those scriptures? What are those scriptures?
But it doesn't say that he is mentioned in those scriptures.
I don't know what to tell you, Chris. It's clear as day.
Because it doesn't mention in Surah 381 that he's mentioned in those scriptures, does it, Aqil?
Yes, when a messenger comes with you, a messenger confirming what you have with you, meaning that you recognize him, as the Quran says, that you recognize him as you recognize your own sons.
No, no, sir. No, no. It says that he is mentioned in the Torah and the Gospel. So now you're saying, well, Muhammad's only mentioned in the Quran then, right? He's not actually mentioned in the Torah and the Injil then?
I don't understand. Ask the question again, Chris.
So it says that he is mentioned in the Torah and the Gospel.
Yes.
And it means we would recognize him by him saying our scriptures are true. Not that he is mentioned in all the scriptures in Surah 381. But in Surah 7:157, it actually says that you can find him in the Torah and the Injil. And that was the actual topic of today. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I would agree. And in the Quran uses different names for the scriptures. This is the point I'm trying to establish with you, as I tried to do when I got my crossfire, but you wouldn't allow me to. The Quran calls the Quran. It also calls it Kitab. It calls it Huda. So it calls it for the Quran. So in
Surah 7:157, where does it say that Muhammad will be found in all of the scriptures, not just the Torah and the Injil?
In Surah 157, it mentions specifically that, but the Quran explains itself. So in one place it says this, and also another place it comments on it even further to show you what it's talking about. You have two.
So basically you're saying that Muhammad said himself in Surah 7:157 that he can be found in the Injil and the Torah. It specifically identifies the Torah and the Injil, but there is no other verse in your Quran that says Muhammad could be found in all these other scriptures that you've presented then, right?
What I'm trying to explain to you, Chris, is that the Torah is generically used for specifically for the first five books of Moses, but also generically for the revelations given to all the prophets.
But as I said in Surah 157, it says that he can be found in the Torah and the Injil. It doesn't say that he can be found in all of these different scriptures, Aqil.
In 381, it makes it quite clear to you, Chris, that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when he comes, you recognize him, you to accept him, and it mentions the scriptures in general, in generic.
Right. Again, your generic use in the Quran is you're adding to Allah's words, and I'm pretty sure that that's forbidden within the Quran.
Okay, guys, that's time. Okay. So that brings us to the conclusion of the cross-examination. I do have to comment and say that the second cross-examination was much handled better by both debaters. So well done for sticking within the rules, both of you. Did a great job. And the crowd agrees with me. Very good. Okay, guys. We have a five-minute closing statement from each debater. Okay, and Aqil will be going first because he went second last night. Aqil, let me know when you're ready and I will start the countdown. There we go. Okay, let me know when you're ready, Aqil.
Okay, so you can start.
Okay, and it started.
Okay, bismillah. So the topic tonight was, is Muhammad prophesied about in the Torah and the Injil? And in the very beginning, I made it quite clear that the Torah and the Injil, they have specific terms, and then also generically it can be applied extensively to outside of those first five books. I gave my proof. I even gave my proof from the Bible itself that Chris refused to accept and acknowledge and answer the question. So given that that's the case, we presented the book of Isaiah, two quotes clearly, that's defined in the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and Chris done nothing whatsoever to address those. He says irrelevant because it didn't come from here, it didn't come from there. He didn't even address it. And remember what I said in the beginning is that he just can't simply deny it. He has to show us who these prophecies are talking about. And if he cannot justify that these prophecies have someone that's applicable to, then that means they go unfulfilled, which means he had gave the litmus test in his own book. If it don't come to pass, it's not from God. So if he can't find this application to the Prophet Muhammad or outside of him, then he has, by default, have made his Bible null and void. I mentioned Isaiah 21, and I mentioned Isaiah 42. We mentioned Kedar. It mentions, let the people of Kedar sing a new song, and let the people of Salih sing at the mountaintops and rejoice. This is in Arabia, no doubt about it. Kedar is the second son of Ismail. Ismail is the father of the Arabs. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is an Arab. Chris asked for proof that somehow Kedar is related to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It's absurd to even ask such a question because it's known historically without any doubt. I didn't get a chance because of time, and I wanted to honor his questions and deal with the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Injil or in the New Testament. I was going to bring John chapter 1, verses 19 and 22, about a prophet that was prophesied about and then lead to other verses. I didn't have time for that. Another point that I wanted to mention that we didn't have time for was the Jews and Christians who accepted Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. When he came to Medina, there were many Jewish rabbis who recognized him, as the Quran says, that they recognized him as they recognized their own sons. And there were many from amongst the rabbis, for instance, like Abdul Ibn Salam, like Al-Ahbar, like Zayd ibn Usana, like the father of Sophia, who married the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who recognized him, like Sophia, who had a dream about him that the moon fell into her lap. Amongst the Christians, we have the Najashi, the Abyssinian king, who took asylum of the Muslims and then also became Muslim himself. So people who had the scripture recognized the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and accepted him as such. Also, the Jews living in Medina. I mentioned before about the people, the Danite people, who moved to Arabia awaiting the final prophet to come. There were many Jewish tribes in Medina doing what? Waiting for that final prophet to come as described in their books. So given the time constraints, we couldn't really unfold the subject fully, but we hope that we presented enough to show that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, clearly, historically, the description, almost line for line in some places, is exactly describing the life of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If Chris or anyone wants to deny this fact, you have to bring an explanation of what these prophecies are about and not go cherry picking and red herring over there to avoid the topic. I brought proofs. Deal with those proofs. Don't tell me they're irrelevant because I quoted Isaiah and whatever the case is. Isaiah is part of the Old Testament. The Muslims and the Christians believe, according to the testimony of Jesus himself, your Lord and Savior, when he quoted the law and quoted Psalms and Isaiah itself, that the word Torah can be inclusive of the whole Old Testament, or the book given to all the prophets, all the scripture that came before, as I showed in verse 381. So we have 381 showing that the prophet is recognized, and when he comes, they should accept him and believe him. How would they accept him and believe him if he don't recognize him? How would they recognize him? By what's in their books. What's in their books? His description. So Chris is avoiding this and trying to red hair about this, about that, but he didn't even deal with Isaiah 21 or Isaiah 42 in seriousness. He brought up about ideology and about this and about that. Nothing to do with the prophecy that clearly mentioned that God given a new song, Kedar, Arabia, and 21, Salat. All of these things point clearly to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. One that will take the people out of idolatry. All of these things so clear. He done nothing in this debate whatsoever to address these points that I brought that I thought was strong indeed. So let Chris come, if he have in his 5 minutes, to address at least one of these and not go off about ideology and quoting about God and this and this. The debate about God was last night. We talking about the Quran, we talking about the Bible or the Torah and Injil prophesizing about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I gave my proofs. Please address at least one of them.
Okay, and that is time. Okay, let me stop, reset. Okay, let me mute you, mute. But Chris, unmute, we're gonna make him spotlight. Okay, Chris, just let me test your audio one more time.
Yeah, Sejaz, do you hear me?
Yeah, you sound perfect. Well done. Okay, so Chris, let me know when you're ready to begin.
Go ahead, Ejaz. You can start now.
Okay, started.
All right, so 381 says, when Allah made his covenant with the prophets. So it's identifying more than one, but we have to understand that in Islam, there is 313 prophets, but only 25 of them are named within the Quran. That means Muslims only know 7% of the prophets that Allah has sent to mankind. Let that one sink in for a minute. Now, the actual topic of the debate is Muhammad prophesied in the Injil and Torah? Surah 7:157 says, those who will follow the messenger, the prophet who can neither read nor write, whom they find described in the Torah and the gospel, which are with them. The Quran identifies the Torah as the books given to Moses. The Injil is the revelation given to Jesus. Last time I checked, he gave zero references of the Injil. He also gave zero references of the Torah given to Moses. So the only thing that he wants to do is he wants to deal with Isaiah, which is not actually a part of the Torah. Aqil cannot appeal to the way Jesus used the word law, since that gospel in John, where he quotes, Jesus says that Jesus is God. And the debate is not how Jesus used the word law, but how Muhammad used it in the Quran. And in the Quran, I would state again that Muhammad identifies the Torah as the books, the revelation given to Muhammad. So I would have to say, Aqil, you failed miserably in trying to provide evidence for your case. And really, there's no need for me to deal with Isaiah, because I've already said Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 to 7, and Isaiah chapter 10, verse 20 to 21, Isaiah is a monotheistic Jew, and he says that the child that will be given, the child that will be born, is El Gibor, the mighty God. Isaiah then turns around in chapter 10, verses 20 to 21, and identifies Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel, as El Gibor. And then we have 63:16, identifying that Yahweh is the Father of Israel, and Isaiah 53, which identifies the Messiah dying for our sins. All of this prove Muhammad was a liar. So since Isaiah believed that the mighty God would be born as a child, and Yahweh is the Father, and the servant dies for our sins, this goes against what Muhammad said in the Quran. So I just want to go over just one more thing here in my opening. I would requote, or I'm just going to go over the last point in my conclusion, or my opening statement for my conclusion. So to conclude my conclusion, I would say that no, Muhammad is not prophesied in the Torah given to Moses and the Injil given to Jesus as a prophet of God. The part that I would say is, we may be able to point to Muhammad is in 1 John chapter 2, verse 22. Who is the liar? It is whoever denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a person is the Antichrist, denying the Father and the Son. So as I said at the start, I believe Muhammad is prophesied in the Bible, but he is prophesied as a liar and as the Antichrist. He is not prophesied as a true prophet. And thank you very much. My time would conclude on that statement. Thank you.
Okay, are you sure you have like 35 seconds left?
No, I'm good, sir.
Okay, so that brings us to the conclusion of the debate series, yesterday's debate and tonight's debate. We have one decision to make, and it's in the hand of both of the debaters. Do you guys want to do a question and answer session or not?
I wouldn't mind another 3, maybe 4 questions each again today. But what I would like to do is maybe have a break, and maybe a 5-minute break before we start.
Yeah, we can take a 5-minute break. That's not a problem. Aqil, are you on board with that plan or no?
That's fine. Whatever Chris wants to do, I'm winning. Whatever you want to do, it's fine for me. Okay.
Well, he wants you to buy some Tim Hortons for him, so.
Well, okay, when I come up there, Tim, I'll buy some Timmy's, man. But I might bring some Dunkin' Donuts across the border, man, because I think that's better than Timmy's.
Good luck on that one.
All right, guys, we're taking a 5-minute break. I'll be muting both the guys. Mute. Right, just to remind everyone, we do have some forms here for you guys to fill out. A feedback form for yesterday's debate, a feedback form for tonight's debate, and we have a debate proposal form. So if you're a Christian or Muslim apologist, atheist, Jewish, whatever you are, you can fill out the debate proposal form, and we'll try to get an opponent that matches your field of study and debate. Please fill out the feedback forms. Every bit of feedback is very important to us. It allows us to know how to manage the debates, what debates to have, what topics that should be debated, when and where. So it's essential. That data is basically necessary. The links have been posted in the chat, so please feel free to read all of them. So we're on a 5-minute break right now, and we'll only take 3 questions from Christians and Muslims, so 6 questions in total. So I'm not sure if you guys can raise your hand. You can, in the chat, I see 2 hands up already. Please raise your hand to ask a question. And when it's your turn to ask, I'll ask you if you're a Christian or a Muslim, and I will decide who goes in what order. Okay, guys? So please raise your hand if you have questions to ask. At present, I believe we have 2 Christian hands up, 0 Muslim hands up. So Muslims, where are you guys? Come on, raise your hands, yeah? We've got Mustafa's iPad. That's good. Sam, if you want to ask a question, put your hand up, man. Right, that would be nice. Okay, we have Kareem as well. Alhamdulillah, praise be to God. So we are 4 minutes away from the Q&A. I personally think that last night's debate and tonight's debate were really well done, that both debaters came well prepared and they had a very lively discussion. Fortunately, I think tonight's cross-examination was a lot more poignant as compared to last night's. They seem to have really hit the mark with tonight's cross-examination. They both did really well. Alhamdulillah, mashallah. The praise is due to God. So we're about, again, 3 minutes and 30 seconds away from the Q&A. Again, I would like to remind everyone to please fill out the forms. Yeah? Fill out the forms, please. We have 4 hands up. You don't have to come on the mic to ask your question, but I will put you on the mic if you want to. So I know DK Man will be on the mic. Jay will also be on the mic. I'm not sure about Kareem and Mustafa. If you don't want to come on the microphone, post your question in the chat area, and I will ask it on your behalf. Can I have my question without? Yes, you can, Muslim Prince. That's not a problem at all. But post the question in the chat when it's your turn, not now, because I would not be able to recover it then, okay? So I'm just looking at the time. We are 2 minutes and 30 seconds out, okay? So we did have a very filled room tonight. We had almost 28, 29 people. So it was, I was expecting much less because it's a Sunday night. A lot of people have work to go to. But maybe that belief about millennials is true, that you guys don't work. Well, you guys, my guys, we're all millennials here, so we don't work at all, apparently. So so you're just waiting for the guys to return. Yep. 2 minutes out. Aqil was just here. He left. And we have a new visitor, 24 people back into the room. Again, guys, raise your hand if you want to ask a question, and I will either read it out for you or you can read it out on the mic. That's not a problem at all. So we'll be right back. We are 2.5 minutes out. So we're 1 minute and a half out from the Q&A session. As a point to note, the questioner reading will have 1 minute to ask the question, and both debaters will have 1 minute each to respond to the question. They will all have 15 seconds over on that 1 minute before they are stopped. So Chris, man, looks like you want to get some coffee. Where's mine? Okay, Aqil will be right back. I just saw him. He's 1 minute out. Yeah, he is. Okay, so I will unmute both of you guys. So both of you should be unmuted, I think. Yeah, that good. Okay, so we have four hands up. Two questions, two questions, okay? EDF Jones, if you have a question, please post it in the chat when it's your turn, so because you'll miss it now. Okay, debaters, are you ready for your first question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. DK Man, are you there? Please indicate in the chat. DK Man 7, are you there? Hello? Okay. You may ask your question. That's it now.
Thanks. Hey, how's it going? First of all, thank you both to you both once again. Very passionate debate. And I hope that you guys do this again in the future. So my question is primarily for Aqil, the Muslim speaker, but it would be great if Chris would comment as well. So the debate title was, does the Torah and Injil prophesy the coming of Muhammad? Now, the first observation and most important observation is that neither of you seem to agree on the definition of the Torah and the Injil, which would mean at minimum we would have to say that it is inconclusive whether Muhammad is in the Torah and Injil, because as Surah 4:157 says, nobody knows for certain what the Torah and the Injil is. Now, Chris wisely took the Quranic definition of Torah as authoritative for Islamic usage, but Aqil took the New Testament usage, such as where Jesus alludes to Isaiah and Psalms being the Torah, as authoritative Christian usage. So the first part of my question for Aqil would be, why would you take what is in the New Testament as authoritative for Islamic usage? Secondly, and finally...
DK Man, your time's up, I'm sorry. You can raise your hand afterwards for the second part. Again, it's a minute per question, okay? DK Man, sorry about that. Okay, so I hope both of the guys got the question. Did Chris and Aqil get the question?
Yeah, I got the question. I'm pretty sure what he meant to say by the ending.
Okay, so I guess that was pointed at Aqil. Aqil, you have 1 minute. Again, please try to keep your answers within 1 minute.
Okay. You may begin. Okay, bismillah. So, yes, that's a very good point, DK, about actually identifying what the Torah is. And one thing that we have to understand is the Quran speaks for itself. It explains itself. The Quran speaks in specific terms in one place and generic in another place. So in chapter 5, verse 48, it says, "And we have revealed to you, O Muhammad, the book, the Quran, in truth, confirming that which preceded it of the scripture as a criterion over it. So judge between them by what Allah has revealed and do not follow their inclinations." So in this verse, Allah is saying, we have revealed to the people scriptures, and the Quran is a protection over it. The Quran is using scripture in a general sense. Everything that came to the people before, and then in some places using a specific sense, Torah or Injil. So for the Muslim, both of them is applicable. And I prove and I back this up by quoting Jesus himself. So it's not that I took the Bible as authoritative. I use both trying to show that the Quran and the Bible has defined Torah as more than just the first five books. And Chris refused to answer about what Jesus stating that fact in the Bible.
Okay, that's time. Chris, you have 1 minute. Let me know when to begin.
Yeah, you can start now. And I believe that DK Man's ending to his question is, why would I appeal to the Quran for my standard of the Torah? Now, what I would say, though, in the answer that Aqil give, is that Aqil said that the Quran speaks for itself. Then why can't it give you the definition of the Quran you gave? Why does the Quran need you to speak for it? In Quran, Surah 5:43 to 48, the scripture it confirms is the Torah and the gospel. So I believe that you're twisting Surah 40 or 548. And my answer to DK, man, is I appeal to the Quranic definition of Torah, because the second debate was the Muslim type topic. So is Muhammad prophesied in the Torah and the Injil would presuppose that we would get the idea of the Torah and the Injil from the Quran, since it affirms Muhammad is a prophet, where the New Testament and the Old Testament do not affirm that Muhammad is a true prophet of God. The only thing that the New Testament and the Old Testament do is show that Muhammad is a false prophet, a liar, and the Antichrist.
Okay, that's 115 seconds. Just give me 1 second here. Kareem, are you a Muslim? I suppose by your name that you are, but I need to confirm. Where is it? DK, Kareem, are you there? Hello? Hello, Kareem, going once, going twice. Okay, Kareem is not there. I'll have to read out this question then. It's from a Mustafa. He asks, here's my question. Jesus was never mentioned, and Moses was not mentioned by name, nor did Moses accept Jesus as Christ. Using your criteria of John 2:22, doesn't this show that Moses of the Bible was the Antichrist? If you disagree, please show us where Jesus was called the Messiah by name in the Torah. Luke 24:44, it says Jesus even said Moses spoke everything about him. So where do we find the explicit mention of Jesus by name in the Torah by Moses? Do you understand that question, Chris?
Yeah, I understand the question for sure.
Okay, all right. So you have 1 minute to answer.
Yeah, basically the topic of the debate is Muhammad prophesied in the Torah and the Injil, which is to say whether Muhammad fits the profile that we see, of course, and whether he confirms or contradicts what is in the Torah and or the Injil. But since this question has nothing to do with is Muhammad prophesied in the Torah and the Injil, I feel that this question is nothing but a red herring and or straw man position to my argument. That'll be my answer.
Okay, all right. Aqil, are you ready? Do you understand the question?
Yes, I do.
Okay, your minute starts.
Quickly, no. Before that, Chris, it seems that it's consistent that he likes to bring up red herrings, and then when he's called on a challenge or refuted and asked about it, he don't want to answer because he claims it's a red herring. You're the one brought up the Antichrist. The question is relevant because you brought it up in your talk. He asked you about something you talked about, and then you say, I don't want to answer it because it's a red herring. If it's a red herring to answer, why is not a red herring to bring it up in the first place? The point being asking is that in prophecy, you have to look and bring together a lot of correlation of verses to identify that prophecy talking about a person, because oftentimes prophecy is not mentioned by name. So because of that, we have to bring and string things together to make sense out of this or to fulfill prophecy. But there's nowhere in the New Old Testament where Jesus ever prophesied by name. So how do we know that he was? Because you look at the things he's bringing and the signs and examples, and you say, oh, this is similar to what's prophesied about. The scripture is clear. This is exactly what I've done with Isaiah 21 and 42. And Chris refused to deal with that. So on his own premise, he's refuting himself.
Okay, that is time. Okay, we know we need a Christian question. So it'll be Jay or Jai. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly. Unmute. Okay, mute you. See if this works. Jai, you should be able to speak. You have 1 minute to ask your question.
Okay. First, I'd like to state, obviously my question is to Aqil. I want to state that you relied entirely on the book of Isaiah today in your opening statement. In the debate, which is titled, Was Muhammad Prophesied in the Torah and Injil? Now, I want to preface my question to you, meaning that I want this to be in your mind when I ask this question again in a more emphatic way. Can you state with absolute certainty that Isaiah is an Islamic prophet with just as much certainty as you can say that Muhammad is an Islamic prophet? That is, for there to be prophecies that Allah gave Isaiah of Muhammad, then Isaiah must be a prophet of Allah. My question is, are you, excuse me, are you 100% certain? So my question pertains to you being 100% certain of these two propositions. Are you 100% certain of one, Isaiah is an Islamic prophet, and two, that the passages you quoted from in the book of Isaiah are penned by Isaiah or were accurately preserved words of the Islamic prophet Isaiah?
Okay, that's time. Okay, that was directed to Aqil. Aqil, do you understand the question?
Yes.
Okay, your minute starts now.
Okay, bismillah. So, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, mentioned to us that there are different prophets and messengers that were sent. And in the Quran, it mentions about the scriptures. As I mentioned in my opening statement, we have scriptures that has been preserved from the previous times. And we accept those scriptures as is. If it contradicts the Quran, we reject it. If it's consistent with the Quran and history, we accept it. The book of Isaiah is a book that proves to be consistent in many cases with what we find historically, as well as aspects in the Quran. So we can accept Isaiah as being a prophet of God based on the principles of Islam. Given that fact, we look in the book of Isaiah and we look at the prophecy that he gave, we look at the descriptions, and we can see quite clearly that these prophecies are exactly in line with the life of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If it's not talking about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, then you have to explain who it is referring to. Even if you don't believe it's about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, there still exists a prophecy there that you have yet to deal with and acknowledge who it's talking about. And if it's unfulfilled, that means your book is false according to your own litmus test.
Okay, that's time. Chris, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, time has started.
Alrighty, so I thank Jay for that question, and I think that Aqil kind of answered it, but he never said I 100% agree that Isaiah is a prophet of Allah, but he was alluding to it. So if Isaiah is a absolute prophet of Allah, Isaiah believes that God is the Father. Isaiah believes that a child will be born who is mighty God. Isaiah believes the servant dies for our sins. This is not something that Muhammad would accept. Isaiah refuted the very notion that Muhammad had. There is no way possible that Isaiah was an Islamic prophet at all. Isaiah contradicts the Quran. He contradicts Muhammad. Therefore, Aqil must actually reject Isaiah as being an absolute prophet of Allah.
Okay, I guess, Chris, you have 15 seconds left?
No, I'm good.
Okay, so we have done the last question was from a Christian, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, but from Jay. Yeah? So yeah. Now we have to take a Muslim question, so we'll be four questions in. Kareem, are you there or not? This is Kareem. Okay, I'm seeing Kareem's question. Just give me a second. Okay, Kareem is asking, this is for Chris. Chris, who is better and more clever in teaching humans, God or you? Because I hear you clearly saying God is a trinity with three persons, but when looking at your scriptures, okay, I don't think this question is relevant to tonight's topic, so I'll have to skip that question. Guys, please keep your questions relevant to tonight's topic. I have to choose a Muslim question next because I just took a Christian one. Is there any other Muslim in the room that wants to ask a question? If not, going once, going twice. Okay, I guess that's it for questions then. Okay, EDF Jones has a question. And Shuaib Ansari. Okay, so EFD Jones asks, who is the servant of the Lord in Isaiah 42? And what are your reasons? I guess that goes to Chris. Did you understand the question, Chris?
Yeah, I understand the question. Okay. What I would actually have to do, though, here, I'll answer the question for him, though. What I would actually have to do is I'd actually have to go through Isaiah and read Isaiah 42 to be able to know who this prophet is that he was speaking of. But what I can say is that Isaiah would not have been identifying Muhammad as a true prophet because Isaiah condemns idols. Also, Isaiah says that the son that was going to be given is mighty God. Isaiah also says the servant will die for our sins. This is all something that Muhammad would reject. So therefore, if Muhammad would reject the very sayings of Isaiah, then Isaiah could not be saying that Muhammad is a prophet of God. Also, Muhammad kissed the black stone. Isaiah 42 condemns idols, so that would be idolatry. And I doubt Isaiah would say that somebody who is an idolater is a true prophet of God. That's my answer. Thank you.
Okay, Chris, you have 15 seconds. Okay, no problem. Aqil, you have 1 minute. Did you understand the question?
Yes, I did.
Okay, time has begun.
Bismillah. So the question is addressing the topic that we dealt with, Isaiah 42. And now we know why Chris didn't deal with my subject, because it seems that he's unfamiliar with this idea of who's in Isaiah 42. But if he's unfamiliar with Isaiah 42, then how can he reject that it is, in fact, about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? All of the things he brought up was interpretation according to Christian theology about these other verses in Isaiah. Like, for instance, the mighty God. I mean, this is debated about being other people. This is all interpretation, Christian interpretation on these verses, and this is not established to be the true interpretation of the only one. But Isaiah 42 has physical descriptions clearly, and in one of them is about idolatry, where the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the strongest crusher of idolatry in the world. When we look at, idolatry, and wholesale, he came in and rid the Arabian Peninsula of idolatry worship. It's only that the Christians are trying to hold on to this idolatry by claiming that God is three in one and making a man a god. But Chris is refuting or denying to accept
it. Okay, your time is up. Your time is up for that answer, Aqil. Okay, we have a Christian question now, and this will be the final Christian question for tonight. It's from Derek Adams, and he's asking, Aqil, and your interpretation of Isaiah 42 is not an Islamic interpretation, Derek is saying no, not his question. Okay, but we need a question from a Christian. Is there a Christian who wants to ask a question? This will be the final Christian question, so we need one more. Okay, Kofi, what's your question? Are you on the mic, Kofi? I'm not seeing you up there. Okay, Derek, I guess you can go. Derek, let me unmute you. Okay, Derek, can you speak?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah, you're good to go. You have 1 minute, please remember that.
Sure. Thank you very much for this next opportunity to ask the question. So what I said last time, hopefully you guys can go to the recording and remember that. But my specific question is, A, since I pointed out Chris appealed to the Islamic usage and Aqil appealed to the New Testament usage, so Chris made more sense than Aqil by doing that, but then Aqil said that he also appealed to the Quran. Okay, so Aqil, if that is the case, please demonstrate for me where in the Quran it uses the word Torah in the senses that you have defined it to mean. So there's various senses. One, the five books of Moses. Two, the Hebrew scriptures or Old Testament as a whole. Three, the original revelation given to Moses. And four, the so-called leftover scriptures that remain intact and consistently in accordance with the Quran. So where does the Quran make any of these distinctions? You're just reading into the Quran, are you not? When it's convenient for your theology. That's all.
Okay, that's time. Okay, thanks for sticking to the time limit, DK. Did both of you guys get that question? Yes. I guess it's aimed at Aqil. So Aqil, you may begin now.
Okay, bismillah. I think that a lot of the questions come from ignorance of the Quran, from people who are asking it. I mentioned the Quran itself has different names. The Quran is called Quran. The Quran is called Furqan. The Quran is called Kitab. The Quran is called Mubin. The Quran is called Nur. So the Quran has different names even about itself. And it has different names also about other scriptures. So it's called, the Torah is called the Torah. The Injil is called the Injil. It's called the scriptures. It's called the books. It's called the Word of God. So there are different names for these scriptures, but when you read the Quran and you see the common thread, God says, I mentioned 548, where it says, and we have revealed to you, O Muhammad, the book, meaning the Kitab, not the Quran. We revealed to you the book. Now in this verse, Allah is calling the Quran the book, Al-Kitab. He didn't say we revealed to you the Quran. He said we revealed to you the book. Here's the Quran using another name for the Quran itself, showing you the Quran does that repeatedly. Then he says that in truth, confirming that which preceded of the scriptures. It mentions scriptures in a general sense. In 381, it mentions scripture in a general sense. What are scriptures talking about? The Torah, the Injil, the Zabur, the Suhuf, and like that. So the Quran explains itself clearly.
Okay, that's time.
That you don't know that.
Aqil, that's time. That's time, Aqil. Okay, Chris, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, your time has begun.
Yeah, so basically what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to try to read DK Man's mind and try to give Aqil a response of what DK Man would have given him to that response. So what? What if the Quran does have different names? That's irrelevant to what the question is that DK Man actually asked him. Nowhere did Aqil show us that the Torah is used for the entire Old Testament within the Quran. So yes, I agree with DK Man. I think that Aqil was just basically appealing to these broad generalizations of the word Torah because he actually realizes that there is no prophecy in the first five books of Moses, which has Muhammad in it, and there is definitely no prophecies of the new or of the Injil, which have Muhammad in them. And this is why Aqil could not give any prophecies from the first five books of Moses, and he could not give any prophecies from the New Testament.
Okay, that's your time, Chris. Okay, we have to take one more question, and I already have a question here from earlier. This question, I guess it's for Chris. Okay, it mentions your name, Chris. It concerns your use of Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. The person asks, Shuaib Ansari, in Isaiah 9, 6, the person is also called Everlasting Father. Is Jesus the Father? So that's the question for Chris. That's the final question of tonight, by the way. Chris, you may begin.
Yeah, it actually says Father of Eternity. And Jesus is God. God creates time. Therefore, calling Jesus the Father of Eternity is actually makes sense. So okay, you actually get the terminology down correct. It means source of eternal life, everlasting Father, or the Father of Eternity. So therefore, yes, Jesus could be the Father of Eternity, meaning the source of eternal life. And that's what it is described in Isaiah 9:6. Also, the word El Gabor is mentioned within Isaiah 9:6 as well, and that could only be translated as the Mighty God. Isaiah used it again in the exact next chapter, in chapter 10, verses 20 to 21, when addressing Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel, by saying that he is the Mighty God, the El Gabor. And of course, Jesus is the second Adam and the father of a redeemed humanity.
Okay, you have 10 seconds left.
No, I'm good.
Okay, Aqil, this is the final question for the night. So you have 1 minute, I believe. It starts now.
Okay, first and foremost, again, what Chris is offering is Christian interpretation on these verses. I mean, there's commentary that, for instance, Al-Gabor is talking about Hezekiah. So this is not something that's established. This is Christian interpretation. And it can be accepted to them or rejected. It's not conclusive, but this is their interpretation because this is what they believe about Jesus Christ. But the idea, when you look at it, in terms of just, you know, logically and factually, you call Jesus, it could be the Father of Eternity. How can he be the Father of Eternity when he died? How can he be the Father of time and eternity when he came to an end? Whether he was resurrected or not, and resurrected by God, nonetheless, he was confined by space and time. So how can the one confined be the Father of time? How can you be the Father of time itself as well as confined in by time? Jesus was born. Jesus was in the womb. Was he the Father of time when he was in the womb of Mary? Was he the Father of eternity in the womb of a woman? We think not.
Okay, and that is time for Brother Aqil. So let me jump back on the video again. Both of you are unmuted. I just wanted to say thank you to Mr. Chris Claus for being a part of these debates, for arranging everything, and he was a pleasure to work with. And Chris, I just have to say that I learned a lot from you over these last two debates, and I look forward to seeing what you bring out in the future. So thank you for engaging in this debate series. Do you have anything to say, Chris?
Yeah, thank you very much, Ijaz, for hosting these two debates. You've actually been rather cordial during these debates, and you've been a very good moderator. And I also do thank you, Aqil, for engaging in these two debates with me. You are definitely very respectful. We are two men that are very passionate about what we believe, and we will see debates like this in the future, hopefully. I had fun with these two debates.
God willing, and hopefully you have them on MAP again. Okay, switching to Aqil. Brother Aqil, again, thank you for being a part of these debates with Mr. Chris Claus. I have to say, behind the scenes, you guys were a pleasure to work with. There was no quarreling, arguing, insulting. It was a great experience to have worked with both of you. And so I thank the both of you for doing an amazing job. Aqil, do you have any words to say to the audience?
First and foremost, you, Jazz, for again hosting it and being a great moderator. Chris, you know, saying again for the invitation and the great discussion. Really appreciate it. And I think that this actually brings me and Chris a little bit closer in spite of our passion and different views. But we appreciate this kind of dialogue. It uplifts both us in our edification of learning and you know, growing in the path of God. So I definitely do appreciate it. And I do look forward to future discussions like this with Chris or whoever we have the opportunity to do that with. And also for those who came out again, I know in some places it's very late. People took their time out to come and attend and enjoy what was presented. So, you know, we thank all. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said that for the people who fail to thank people, they have failed to thank Allah. Failed to thank God. So it's an obligation upon us to give our thanks and appreciation for whatever we see from people. And by that, we show our appreciation from God, who is ultimately the source of all goodness.
Thank you, Brother Aqil. So just a quick update. Both of you guys will be having a Q&A session, I believe, sometime during the week. Is that correct?
Yeah, Aqil is going to talk on Facebook and try to set up a good day or evening. I think probably around 4-5 o'clock, maybe better, because I think maybe your UK Muslims want to join that as well. So I think that we will set that up in about 4 or 5 days, just a question and answer about what happened in the last couple of days. That's all.
Well, if you guys want, we have the Zoom room available for both of you, as well as our YouTube channel. So we have, if you want us to partake, we'll be there for you. I guess that's it. I want to thank the both of you again for being part of the series. The recording teams have come out just fine. Just one note, I encourage everyone to fill out the forms, including Chris and Aqil. Give us your feedback. I have looked at the feedback for both debates, and it is unanimous. No one has put a negative statement about either Chris or Aqil. They both have said you guys is debated well, you were respectful, and you represented the topics properly. So that's amazing that everyone can agree on that. Okay, guys, that's it. Have a good night, and we look forward to the recording being published. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, all right, Chris. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it, man.